New Thinking Aloud. Conversations on the leading edge of knowledge and discovery with parapsychologist Jeffrey Mishlove.
Hello and welcome. I'm Jeffrey Mishlove. Today, we'll be exploring the subject of apparitions. With me is Professor Stephen Braude, former chairman of the philosophy department at the University of Maryland, and author of many interesting books of a parapsychological nature and a paranormal nature, including Limits of Influence, The Gold Leaf Lady, ESP and Psychokinesis, Crimes of Reason, First Person Plural, and Immortal Remains. Welcome, Stephen.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
It's a pleasure to be with you. People are often confused by the term apparitions because some people might think it means hallucinations. Other people might think it means ghosts. How do you view the subject?
It is a confusing term, apparitions, and one of the reasons I think it's confusing is that members of the Society for Psychical Research often classified apparitions as a form of hallucinations, sometimes veridical hallucinations. Mm-hmm. So that's a very strange use of the term hallucination, but it's contributed to the unclarity, I think.
Let's define for our viewers what a veridical hallucination might be.
Well, if, for example, I hallucinated a human figure telling me about something happening at a remote location, and then it turned out that, in fact, what the hallucination was telling me happened at the remote location was, in fact, happening. Mm-hmm. That would be a veridical hallucination, where something in the hallucinatory experience corresponded to an actual state of affairs.
Yeah. Oh, okay. In the 19th century, the Society for Psychical Research began collecting individual accounts of such events.
Thousands of them. Mm-hmm. And classified into two major categories, apparitions of the dead and apparitions of the living. Mm-hmm. And they had huge collections of both sorts.
Yeah. Apparitions of the living, suggesting that a person might be able to concentrate on being in another location, and people in that other location might have an experience of seeing them there or her there.
Yes, and it was something of a pastime in the late 19th century. People would often experimentally try to make apparitions of themselves appear to others.
Mm-hmm. And I think in other cultures this sort of thing is also known to occur in Tibetan Buddhism, for example.
Well, you're the authority on that, but I believe that is the case.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, in Asia, it often happens as well.
Yeah. So you've got apparitions of the living,
correct,
which you would ascribe to psychokinesis.
Well, not always.
Yeah.
There are different kinds. There are apparitions that are experienced only by one person.
Mm-hmm.
And for those, in many cases, the best explanation might be a telepathic explanation. And some of those are crisis apparitions where the apparitional experience occurs more or less simultaneously with a crisis in the life of the person or the individual of whom there's an apparition.
Yes.
And sometimes those are animal apparitions.
Mm-hmm.
There's a very famous case of Rider Haggard who experienced an apparition of...
Famous novelist.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Of his dog Bob, which apparently coincided, they discovered later, with Bob's being hit by a train and getting killed.
Yeah. Well, as I recall, the crisis apparition was the single most commonly reported spontaneous psychic experience collected by the society in the 19th century.
Yes, that's correct.
And I can tell you, just parenthetically, I experienced a crisis apparition. I guess it would be called that. It happened in a dream. I was dreaming, and a great uncle of mine, with whom I had had no contact for perhaps a decade or so, appeared in my dream. It was very, very moving to me. When I woke up from the dream, I was crying and singing at the same time. So it was one of those experiences that is more real than real, in emotionally. In particular, I've never in my life had an experience like that, crying and singing at the same time.
One of the things that strikes me about apparitions mm-hmm. is that you and I have many cases discussed how academics and other professionals often don't really admit in public that they've had paranormal or ostensibly right. paranormal experiences. But among those academics who have told me about their experiences, mm-hmm. they've almost invariably been apparitional experiences. Mm-hmm. An ex-father-in-law who was an anatomist at Ohio State had an apparitional experience of seeing his old friend Harry, I think his name was, while my father-in-law was busy fixing some lures for fly fishing. And it wasn't until a few moments into the experience that he realized his friend was actually dead, mm-hmm. and so he shouldn't have been there.
Yeah.
My dissertation advisor had an apparitional experience of a woman climbing in his bedroom window. Now, these are things that they don't admit to anybody but me, but I find it interesting that the experiences are actually quite common.
Well, and I imagine almost every parapsychologist who gives public talks has had the experience of people coming up to them afterwards,
yes.
and they often preface their remarks with this phrase, I've never told anybody else before about
right.
this,
right.
but I want to tell you because they know it's safe.
Yes.
And so these are common experiences that are just not discussed because it's sort of a taboo topic.
It is. One thing I should also mention is that although the large majority of apparitional experiences seem to be visual, mm-hmm. They're not always visual. Sometimes it could be an auditory or an olfactory apparitional experience, but localized in a certain place.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes animals respond to the location even before the humans experience something at that location.
Now, in your book, Limits of Influence, where you have a chapter on apparitions, you bring up the fact that animals sometimes respond, and you suggest that that seems to indicate that the apparition might not just be a mental phenomenon, but it might represent something that is in some sense physical.
In some ways, the cases that interest me the most are the ones where the apparition is collectively observed.
Mm-hmm.
Because there, the telepathic explanations for the apparitions, which might work pretty smoothly for individual experiences,
yeah.
Are, I think, strained to the breaking point.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason for that is this. The two main telepathic theories of collective apparitions are as follows. One I call the shotgun theory. That's where we suppose that the individual of whom there's an apparition telepathically affects a bunch of people at the location where the apparition is seen,
right.
but affects them individually.
Mm-hmm. Which might account for the fact that not everybody will see an apparition that is seen collectively by many people.
Yes, that's considered to be one of the at least superficial advantages of it.
Mm-hmm.
Another variant of the telepathic theory would be what I call the infection theory,
mm-hmm.
and that is where the person of whom there's an apparition telepathically influences one person at the scene. That person then affects individually or collectively the other people at the scene so that the apparition is dramatically appropriate and a bunch of people, all or many of them, seem to experience the apparition.
And that infection might be through paranormal means or maybe through normal means.
Could be, mm-hmm. yes. Now, what I like to think about the collective cases is that another live option, and in some ways the better option, is to suppose that the apparition experienced collectively is an actual object at the location produced psychokinetically by the individual of whom there's an apparition.
Mm-hmm.
And even there, the fact that not everybody experiences the object can make a lot of sense. There are all sorts of physical objects that are not visible from every angle.
Yeah.
Think of rainbows, electromagnetic fields, gases, mirror images.
Mm-hmm.
These are all phenomena that are localized in a certain region of space, but where people have to be positioned in a certain way in order to experience them.
Well, the idea of a mirror image is a very intriguing one. Some people, you have to be positioned just right.
Right.
To see it. I think one of the most intriguing aspects of apparitions is that sometimes people interact with them.
Yes, they've been known to chase them, they've been known to speak to them, and the apparitions seemingly respond. Or well, I should say just seemingly respond, because they might try to talk to them and the apparition might wave, but sort of vacantly wave.
Yeah.
There's not the kind of interaction usually that you get in cases suggesting postmortem survival, where there's real back and forth between the entities.
Well, Raymond Moody, who is the pioneer in the field of near-death experience, has also done extensive investigations of apparitions. He created a technique for producing apparitions known as the psychomantium, where people situate themselves in a darkened room, maybe with a black background such as we have here, but the lights out, and a mirror in the room, and often prepare themselves psychologically and experience apparitions then, often of departed loved ones. Now, Moody doesn't believe that this is necessarily a paranormal phenomenon. He thinks of it more in terms, I think, of a psychological projection. But he told me that on one occasion, after being in the psychomantium for a few hours, he walked into his own living room, and there, sitting on a couch, was an aunt of his, and he sat down and he conversed with her, he said, for about an hour, back and forth, normal conversation, before it dawned on him that she had died and wasn't alive, and then she just sort of evaporated, or he turned away, and then he looked back and she was gone. And then he realized that the whole experience was not a normal experience, not a conventionally physical experience. He insists that it must have been a psychological projection on his part.
That would certainly make sense in that case. And again, that's one reason I think the collective cases are so interesting, because they're a paranormal explanation of some kind seems mandatory, although it's not clear what. And let me, I never did say what was wrong with the telepathic explanations of collective cases. The main problem seems to be that it's very difficult to appeal to telepathy to explain why people at the scene where the apparition is experience the apparition at the same time and from appropriate positions in space. I mean, one of the things I think that makes sense to say about telepathy is that, assuming it's real, of course, it's at least a two-stage process. First, there's going to be a kind of interaction or stimulus stage where the remote individual of whom there's an apparition telepathically interacts with the person who experiences the apparition. And then there's a manifestation or response stage. And there can always be a delay between the interaction and the response stage, or the stimulus and response stage. And in fact, it's a well-known phenomenon in apparitional cases that there is a delay. This is called telepathic deferment. And it's believed by many that deferment occurs because the people who experience an apparition have to be in the right mindset to have it in the first place. Maybe it's a state of relaxation. And this is why in crisis cases, the apparitional experience isn't had until sometime after the actual crisis, when the person is about to fall asleep or resting in a chair or something of that sort.
The recipient.
The recipient, yes.
Yeah, because if it's telepathy, you need a sender and a receiver.
Yes, that's probably a clearer way of putting it. So the puzzle in the telepathic explanations of collective cases is why the various recipients should be having the experience of the apparition at the same time, if there could be a kind of delay. They might not all be in the right mindset to experience an apparition at that time. And not only that, but just as every other experience we have is going to be filtered through our own collection of biases, predispositions, and favorite images, and so on, you know, putting its own idiosyncratic cognitive stamp on our experiences. It's not clear why, either on the shotgun or the infection theories, so many people at the scene of the apparition would have concordant experiences.
Now, in your book, you report on a number of interesting cases. As I recall, in one of them, the apparition actually appeared to be eating.
Yes, that was an Asian case. It could equally be regarded as a case of bilocation, where he was seen at one location and then seen apparently in a physical form at another location where he had some tea and cookies.
And then in the first location, he told, this is some type of Indian guru who
yes.
practiced bilocation as
yes.
a spiritual discipline, and he told his disciples, check in this other city to
That's
see
right.
if they can confirm that I was there.
Yeah, this is an unusual case because there were physical traces of the apparition's presence.
Mm-hmm.
That's very unusual because apparitions don't usually leave any physical trace.
Yeah.
They seem to pass through walls or doors and things of that sort, but they don't leave any marks behind.
In this particular instance, the bilocated individual or the apparition asked a child to provide food
yes.
and tea, as I recall.
Yes, and the tea was found later to be partially consumed and the cookie as well.
Mm-hmm. So I guess we have to look at out-of-body experiences, bilocation, is somehow related to apparitions, particularly apparitions of the living.
I would think so, and there are so many puzzles. I actually don't know what to say. One of the standard questions that gets raised about apparitional cases is captured by a familiar question. Why do ghosts wear clothes?
Mm-hmm.
So why? We tend to think that if the apparition is a secondary body of the person
yeah.
appearing at another location, why does that individual secondary body come clothed in anything at all? Why
yeah.
shouldn't we be seeing more examples of naked apparitions?
Mm-hmm.
But in fact, apparitions are seen wearing clothes, sometimes accompanied by animals.
Mm-hmm. Who are not wearing clothes.
Yes, right.
right. Well, which is what we're accustomed to see in normal physical experience. So it could be a psychological projection of the recipient, or it could be maybe part of the accoutrement of bilocating.
It's hard to know what to say,
yeah.
but it's one of the reasons I'm tempted to look seriously
yeah.
at the psychokinetic explanation
mm-hmm.
of at least collective apparition.
Sure.
Because, you know, you might be tempted to say the apparition itself, the human figure or the animal figure,
mm-hmm.
is an actual projection of an individual secondary body. But then what are you going to say about the clothes? If that's a psychokinetic accoutrement,
mm-hmm.
Then why not say that the apparition itself is a psychokinetic object?
Well, it seems as if you're getting into a very fuzzy area here, because you're talking about these psychokinetic apparitions as being physical, but not fully physical the way you and I are talking to
not
each other.
Not like solid bodies.
Not like solid bodies. It sort of evokes various esoteric concepts like the astral body or the etheric body. And as I recall, you're not too comfortable with that line of thought either.
No, what I actually connect the apparitions to rather is materialization phenomena in cases of physical mediumship.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there we have lots of well-attested cases of physical mediums producing partial materializations, you know, of just limbs, or full figure materializations.
Yeah.
And in some of those cases, the materialized figures have been examined very carefully by physicians, for example. In the famous Brazilian case of Carlos Mirabelli, he produced full figure materializations ostensibly in broad daylight.
Mm-hmm.
Attending physicians would record ordinary bodily functions, and then the materialized figure would melt into the floor, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got that substantial body of evidence, and I don't see why we need to suppose that materialized figures must occur at the same location as the person producing the materialized figure.
Mm-hmm. No, I can imagine that it could well be distant. So now we're talking about what, I guess it was Charles Roche, the Nobel laureate, French physiologist, termed ectoplasm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Not a clear term, granted, because it seems to cover a variety of different kinds of materials and phenomena, from
yeah.
Paper-like flat cutouts to apparently living human or living forms that
mm-hmm.
exude from a medium's orifices, sometimes evolve into shapes like a little hand that wiggles its fingers.
Yeah. It's almost like Play-Doh or
something like that.
Some sort of substance that can take many different forms, textures, and shapes, can be photographed, can be touched, sometimes feels like living tissue, sometimes does not.
And then dematerializes.
Mm-hmm.
The thing about materialized figures is that they always dematerialize. So they may have been there for a while. The other thing about materialized figures, and this may get us somewhat off topic, but I think it's an interesting digression. The form that these ectoplasmic manifestations take might be the result of a certain kind of experiment or effect. Let me give you an example. One of the great mediums from the heyday of physical mediumship was an Irish medium, a young woman named Kathleen Gallagher.
Mm-hmm.
Her principal investigator was W.J. Crawford, a mechanical engineer. And Crawford wanted to understand how Kathleen was able to levitate tables. And he conjectured that she was exuding ectoplasm, which would brace itself on the floor and raise the table as if it was a cantilever.
Oh.
And he actually took photographs of the ectoplasm coming out of her abdomen, bracing itself on the floor, and then propping up the table.
Uh-huh.
Now, think of it. That would be exactly the kind of explanation of table levitation that might appeal to a mechanical engineer.
Yes.
Meanwhile,
it's certainly not consistent with many other examples of table levitation.
Right. Now, on the continent in Europe, Richet and Jaili and some others were examining another medium named Eva C.,
mm-hmm.
whose ectoplasmic manifestations were much more biological in nature.
Yes.
So Jaili, Schrenk, Notzing, and Richet all reported watching this stuff ooze out of Eva C. and
sometimes
creep
coming out of her vagina, as
yes.
I recall. Yes.
Creep along the floor, take mm-hmm. the shape of, beginning to take the shape of a hand and then more fully formed hand and wiggle
mm-hmm.
the fingers.
Yes.
Now, all three of those investigators were biologists or physiologists.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the form of the ectoplasm seems peculiarly adapted to their own professional dispositions. There was an opportunity missed at this point in history because nobody was taking experiment or effects very seriously
yes.
at the time. I think it would have been really revealing, or at least potentially, and certainly interesting, for those investigators to switch mediums, for Jay Lee and the rest to study Kathleen Gallagher, mm-hmm. and for Crawford to study Eva C., and to see whether the ectoplasm that they observed conformed to the expectations of the experimenter or to the traditions mm-hmm. of the medium that were already established.
Because there's a lot of thought these days in parapsychology that these phenomena are systems effects, that all of the people involved in the social milieu come together to produce the phenomena.
At least potentially. We have no way of knowing exactly who's contributing what or how much.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the only sensible approach to take is that everybody even remotely connected, and maybe some people not so connected to the experiment, might have a hand in producing the final result.
Yeah. I suppose it's worth mentioning in closing that sometimes apparition-like phenomena occur produced artificially, such as the Philip experiment in Toronto.
Yes, that's a case you could say of PK by committee,
mm-hmm.
Where the members of the Toronto Society for Psychical Research created a character called Philip. They gave him an entirely fictitious history. They spent a lot of time really immersing themselves in the story of Philip. And then they tried to communicate at a seance with Philip.
Mm-hmm.
They got raps in the table. They got table levitations, or at least movements, and the table flipping itself over. And the responses to questions they asked to Philip were appropriate to what they knew about Philip. So if
the
they
story
asked,
they had created.
Yes. Yeah, so if they asked the character Philip something to which they didn't have a clear answer, Philip's responses via raps were always rather indistinct. But when it was an answer that they would easily have expected, the responses were very strong.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this is a case where not quite an apparition, because nobody claimed to have seen Philip, but everything else suggested there was a character in the room.
Yes. And so it's a reminder that we shouldn't too glibly adopt a survivalist interpretation of phenomena that look very much like standard mediumistic phenomena.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess it's also a reminder that when people report these sorts of bizarre experiences that it's not wise to dismiss them out of hand, as so many people tend to do.
Right. It's certainly not just something that can be attributed to hypnosis or hallucination, for example. Those are very weak explanations. Mm-hmm. So when everybody at a seance experiences the same ostensible paranormal physical phenomenon, if we try to say that the medium just hypnotized, and that usually is a way of betraying your ignorance about the nature of hypnosis. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things we definitely know about hypnosis is that people differ sometimes dramatically in their degree of hypnotic susceptibility. So there really is no evidence for collective hypnosis of the kind that would be required to explain away cases of physical mediumship.
Stephen Browdy, thank you so much for being with me. I know we could talk a long time about apparitions, materializations, apports, macro psychokinesis, and physical mediumship, and I hope we pursue this topic even further.
I'm sure we will. Thank you.
And thank you for being with us.